Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the previous lecture, we saw that a system of linear equations is called a dependent system if it contains any equations which are dependent. So how can we tell if a system of equations is dependent? It is usually easy to spot when two equations in the system are multiples of each other. But it is not always easy to tell when a group of more than two equations are linear combinations of each other. Fortunately, the process of Gauss-Jordan elimination automatically takes care of this without us having to know whether or not the system is dependent. If the system is dependent, once the system is in reduced row echelon form, the result will be an independent system of fewer equations from which the solution set can be easily determined. So let's look at a few examples of what happens when Gauss-Jordan elimination is performed on a dependent system of equations. In this example, the second equation is a multiple of 2 times the first equation, and so the first equation is a multiple of 1/2 times the second equation. Therefore, this pair of equations is dependent. Now let's represent this system of equations as a matrix. Graphically, each matrix row corresponds to a plane. Rows 1 and 2 describe identical planes, and row 3 describes a plane which is distinct from the other two. So let's use Gauss-Jordan elimination to transform this matrix to reduced row echelon form. We start by changing the first row's leading entry to a 1 using a scale operation to multiply row 1 by 1/4. Next, we change the entry below that 1 to a 0 using a pivot operation to add negative 8 times row 1 to row 2. But in addition to zeroing the leftmost entry of row 2, this operation causes every entry in row 2 to become 0. The reason this happened is that rows 1 and 2 were multiples of each other. Therefore, whatever multiplier was used in the pivot operation to zero one entry in row 2 ended up zeroing every entry in row 2. Since in reduced row echelon form, any rows containing all zeros must be positioned at the bottom of the matrix, we now use a swap operation to exchange rows 2 and 3. Now we must once again zero the leftmost entry of row 2, so we use another pivot operation to add negative 4 times row 1 to row 2. We then move to the second column, changing the second row's leading entry to a 1, using a scale operation to multiply row 2 by 1/16. This matrix now satisfies 3 of the 4 requirements for reduced row echelon form. Rows containing all zeros are positioned at the bottom of the matrix. The first non-zero entry of each row is a 1, and each leading entry lies to the right of the leading entry in the row above. However, to be in reduced row echelon form, each leading entry must be the only non-zero entry in its column. Although the leading entry for row 1 is the only non-zero entry in its column, the leading entry of row 2 is not. Therefore, we must change the entry above row 2's leading entry to a 0. This can be accomplished using another pivot operation, adding 1 times row 2 to row 1. Since both leading entries in the matrix are now the only non-zero entry in their column, this matrix is in reduced row echelon form. Converting the matrix back into equations, eliminating the terms with coefficients of 0, eliminating the coefficients of 1, and the equation 0 equals 0, gives us an equivalent system containing two independent equations. So Gauss-Jordan elimination has transformed a dependent system of three linear equations into an equivalent independent system of two linear equations. In addition, these equations are simpler than the original equations since each equation contains fewer variables. Although the planes corresponding to this new system are different than the original planes, their intersection line, which represents the solution set of the system, is the same. This infinite solution set can now be written in parametric form, as we will see after the next lecture. And Gauss-Jordan elimination has produced simpler equations, which makes the process of creating this parametric representation much easier. In the next example, we will see what happens to a system of three linear equations when all three equations are multiples of each other. In this example, the second equation is a multiple of 2 times the first equation, and the third equation is a multiple of 3 times the first equation. Therefore, all three equations are multiples of each other, and all three equations are dependent. Since the three equations all have the same solution set, they all correspond to the same plane, and so any two of them can be eliminated without affecting the solutions of the system. Now let's represent this system of equations as a matrix and see what happens when we transform it to reduced row echelon form. Once again, we start the process of Gauss-Jordan elimination by changing the first row's leading entry to a 1 using a scale operation to multiply row 1 by 1/4. We then change the entry below that to a 0, using a pivot operation to add negative 8 times row 1 to row 2. Since in reduced row echelon form, any rows containing all zeros must be positioned at the bottom of the matrix, we use a swap operation to exchange rows 2 and 3. Now we must once again zero the leftmost entry of row 2. So we use another pivot to add negative 12 times row 1 to row 2. This matrix now satisfies all the requirements for reduced row echelon form. Rows containing all zeros are positioned at the bottom of the matrix. The first non-zero entry of each row is a 1, and that leading entry is the only non-zero entry in its column. If we convert this matrix back into equations, eliminate the coefficients of 1, and equations which equate 0 to 0, we have an equivalent system consisting of only a single equation. Just as in the previous example, this system has infinitely many solutions, corresponding to the infinite number of points contained in the plane described by this equation. This infinite solution set can now be written in parametric form, as we will see after the next lecture. Now let's see how Gauss-Jordan elimination simplifies a dependent system of three linear equations, where each equation is a linear combination of the other two. In this example, no two equations are multiples of each other. However, although it is certainly not obvious by looking at the equations, each equation is actually a linear combination of the other two. The first equation is 4/11 times the third equation plus -5/11 times the second equation. The second equation is 4/5 times the third equation plus -11/5 times the first equation. And the third equation is 11/4 times the first equation plus 5/4 times the second equation. Therefore, all three equations are dependent. Unlike the previous examples, since these equations are not multiples of each other, each one has a different solution set and describes a different plane. So let's represent this system of equations as a matrix and see what happens when we transform the matrix to reduced row echelon form. Once again, we start the process of Gauss-Jordan elimination by changing the first row's leading entry to a 1 using a scale operation to multiply row 1 by 1/4. We then change the entry below to a 0 using a pivot to add -4 times row 1 to row 2. And we change the entry below that to a 0 using a pivot to add -16 times row 1 to row 3. Although this was not the case before, rows 2 and 3 are now multiples of each other. Row 2 is 4/5 times row 3, and row 3 is 5/4 times row 2. It is not necessary that we notice that this has happened, but since rows 2 and 3 are now multiples of each other, row 3 will later become all zeros. This all happens automatically during the process of Gauss-Jordan elimination. Now we move to the second column, changing row 2's leading entry to a 1 using a scale operation to multiply row 2 by 1/16. We then change the entry below that to a 0 using a pivot to add -20 times row 2 to row 3. But since rows 2 and 3 were multiples of each other, every entry in row 3 has become 0. As a result, we now have a matrix which represents a system of only two equations. To be in reduced row echelon form, each row's leading entry must be the only non-zero entry in its column. Although the leading entry for row 1 is the only non-zero entry in its column, the leading entry of row 2 is not. Therefore, we must change the entry above row 2's leading entry to a 0. We do this with another pivot, adding 1 times row 2 to row 1. Since both leading entries in the matrix are now the only non-zero entry in their columns, this matrix is in reduced row echelon form. Converting this matrix back into equations, eliminating the terms with zero coefficients, eliminating coefficients of 1, and the equation 0 equals 0, we now have an equivalent system of two independent equations. So once again, Gauss-Jordan elimination has transformed a dependent system of three linear equations into an equivalent independent system of two linear equations. And once again, these equations are simpler than the original equations, since each equation contains fewer variables. The planes corresponding to those equations are also different. However, since the systems are equivalent, the solution sets of the two systems are the same, corresponding to the infinite number of points contained in the intersection line of the planes. So even though the planes are different, their line of intersection is the same. This infinite solution set can now be written in parametric form, as we will see after the next lecture. And once again, Gauss-Jordan elimination has produced equations which will make the process of creating this parametric representation much easier.